Traveling at the near speed of light, energetic particles shooting out from the sun can zip through space, smack into our planet's atmosphere, and cause incredible disruptions. And one of the biggest impacts we know of happened during the tail end of the Vietnam War.
President Nixon really wanted to pull us out, but wanted to do so sort of saving face, and decided that the best way to do that was to stop the flow of war material into North Vietnam. And the decision was to mine Haiphong Harbor and many of the smaller harbors to the south.
This is Delores Knipp, a space weather scientist and former officer in the U.S. Air Force. She likes digging into dusty archives and uncovered a war mystery that's now connected to a major solar event.
Space weather forecasters had noticed that there was one region on the sun that appeared to be a little more active than anticipated. They kept watching it, and then when it came around in late July of 1972 on the east limb of the sun, it was already large. It did start producing solar flares, producing coronal mass ejections, but at that time, we didn't have those words. We didn't really understand the concept of the sun actually throwing mass and magnetic material out. We had a general sense that something like a plasma cloud was coming at us. But our ideas were that, well, okay, it might get here in a couple, 3 days. As a matter of fact, it got here in 14.6 hours. Typically, the solar wind is moving at about 400 kilometers per second, which is supersonic, but very, very tenuous.
But this particular event in 1972
traveled at about 2,800 kilometers per second, so 7 times faster than the norm, and carrying tremendous magnetic field and mass with it. And when that hit, our magnetic shield virtually buckled. We had no idea that something could come from the sun that fast. We were pretty much unprepared.
And when it hit Earth, those sea mines blew up.
Those sea mines were what the president was relying on to keep the pressure on and end the war. And suddenly, the whole minefield had been swept by nature, by the sun, by a CME. That created probably one of the largest solar energetic particle events in recorded history. The naval observers who were up at the time, it was just past dawn, noted that there were a half dozen sea mines that blew within 30 seconds. And they go, "Whoa, did we do that?" It was a furious time in terms of the Navy records trying to figure out what had happened.
In these declassified reports, Delores found just a few lines that had
basically said, yes, in August of 1972, a solar storm swept the sea mines in Haiphong Harbor. And so I go, oh, it looks like something did happen. So there were and are many impacts that have not been adequately described. And they're just now starting to come to light.
Our sun is a huge ball of magnetized gas and plasma, and its activity goes through a roughly 11-year cycle. We know whether we're in a solar maximum or solar minimum by counting the number of sunspots on the surface. These spots are indicators for giant eruptions, like solar flares, which are sudden outbursts of energy, and coronal mass ejections, which are even larger but slower eruptions from the sun's corona. They can increase during the sun's cycle, but luckily, we have some built-in protection.
We can think of Earth's magnetic field as being kind of a magnetic cocoon that keeps most of the solar wind's magnetic field and the plasma outside of Earth's atmosphere. But when the sun decides to launch a really big ejection, sometimes the magnetic field has to deform so dramatically that currents are generated, and those currents can actually flow along the magnetic field lines down to Earth's surface. And that's one of our biggest concerns, because if those extra currents are flowing in the ground, they're always looking for the path of least resistance. And when they find a path along a long conducting pipe, or in older times, telegraph wires, or now in our power grid, they will take that path. We're starting to understand that these are not once-in-a-century events. These probably occur more often than we think. we're in solar minimum now, we're kind of relaxed, you know, but the next solar maximum was kind of forecast to be not too spectacular. But the August 72 event came out of small sunspot cycles. So we can't just take the sunspot count as the, oh, we don't have to worry about it situation. We actually have to be monitoring the sun 24/7.
Today at NOAA's Space Weather Prediction Center, we have more eyes on the sun and better models to help us predict space weather, which is...
It's affecting our magnetosphere, it's creating the aurora, it's also energizing particles and creating radiation environment that can affect satellites, that affects the ionosphere in those regions, and that impacts airlines that have flights, like from New York to Beijing. There are several things that are really important for conducting space weather operations.
The first are satellites, which serve as sentinels out in the abyss.
The GOES satellites give you the daily weather that you see on the news at night. But in addition, the space weather observations consist of monitoring the energetic particles in Earth's radiation belt at geosynchronous orbit. They also monitor the Earth's magnetic field and its variations. There's solar observations that are looking at the sun in X-rays and extreme ultraviolet to give us information about activity on the sun.
Activity like coronal mass ejections and solar flares, which have different lead times once they erupt.
We classify solar flares here starting with what we could call A, and then we have the B level, and then C level, and then M's, and then X's. And each one of those categories is 10 times more intense than the other.
The 1972 event that blew up a bunch of sea mines were connected to X-class flares.
We have instruments measuring the intensity of the solar radiation, and it appears very quickly in near real time in front of our forecasters, and then they can use that information to provide their warnings and alerts. The other type of major events, this coronal mass ejection, is moving much slower. Right now, we're using coronagraphs that are on NASA's satellite. It takes as short as maybe 14 hours to reach us for a very fast event, but it can take more normally of several days to reach us. We have a little bit more lead time to say something about how fast is it moving, when do we expect it at Earth, how long do we expect it to last. We've got another satellite that's entirely outside of Earth's magnetosphere at a location between Earth and the sun called the Lagrange point, L1. And that's a stable place where both the gravity and the centrifugal force of the satellite balance out the Earth's gravitational force. And so it's always there as a buoy upstream to give us a warning of what's coming at Earth.
Another key piece of their operations are models, which are constantly evolving to improve predictions.
The Wang-Shiley-RJN little model shows us where there's high-speed solar wind coming at us, where there's low-speed solar wind, the density of that solar wind. When there's a large eruption on the sun of a coronal mass ejection, the Wang-Shiley-RJN little model takes that coronal mass ejection and puts it through that system, and then it tells us what's going to arrive at Earth. The geospace model is telling us about magnetic variations in the vicinity of Earth. And those magnetic variations can cause geoelectric fields. Those geoelectric fields can drive currents in power lines and disrupt power grids. Models are only as good as our understanding, and models don't catch everything. And there are times where we have been surprised. There are a lot of features about the sun that we still don't understand. We need to be able to model how the sun's interior works, the solar atmosphere. We need to be able to monitor active regions of the sun and how they form. There's a huge concern at the highest levels in government to be able to better prepare for a large event to better mitigate the effects. I'm optimistic about all of these new advances that are coming and all of these things which are going to contribute to our preparedness for the things the sun is throwing at us.
It's a real sense of adventure. It's like you can realize that you're part of something that is developing. The sun, it's so far away. And yet, within a short amount of time, it can have this amazing impact. And it's not just, oh yeah, the sun warms us up and, you know, we have these seasons. There's a lot more going on, and it's a very connected system. Even though some of these stories have been hidden, these things have actually happened, and there's a potential for it to happen again.